singing the songs, it just struck me. We're singing about the blood of Jesus Christ, about our need, about our to have our sins forgiven, to be touched by God, and to be healed, about His resurrection, about His hope. You know, it struck me that we take for granted that everybody here has heard that message. And my guess is, living in the United States and our communities, we probably have heard that message. But the real question is, have we responded to that message? Have you asked Jesus Christ to personally forgive your sins? To not just be part of a church, to not just read your Bible and to favor Christian things, but being a child of God and taking that first step. It's all about that for one time, humbling ourselves before God, recognizing our sin, confessing ourselves as sinners to Him, in need of a Savior, and Jesus Christ forgiving us. And the message isn't going to be specifically dealing with that this morning, but as we were singing those songs, I couldn't help but just be struck with the thought. It's easy to just talk about it and assume that we all have that. Unless you have personally done that, you can even mark to say, I remember when I was lost, and then I came to Christ. I gave my life to Christ. I asked Him to be my Lord and Savior. If you can't identify that, we would love to talk to you. And whoever it's appropriate for you to talk to, whether, if you're one of the teens or young people, if you want to talk to Pastor Matt, or if you're a lady and you want to talk to one of the women of the church, or myself, we would love to talk to you and help you, through those steps to understand how to become a Christian. And I want to just open us in prayer before we go to God's Word. Let's just pray for one another in this area. Lord, I ask You to move in our hearts. Father, it would be the greatest tragedy, for us to be under the teaching of Your Word, to be part of a church, but not part of Your family. So individually, Father, challenge each of us. Help us look into our heart to make sure, Father, that we have made that decision, that we have in faith stepped out and accepted Your death on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. That it was a genuine decision. That that's our hope. That that's the future, Lord, that we are living for. Father, I pray for anyone here that, Father, is maybe struggling with that. The words, the seed's been planted, it's being watered. But Father, they need something in their heart for You to touch, Lord, for them to see fruit. And I pray whatever it is, Lord, that You will speak to their hearts today. You will bring conviction. Father, You will cause them and allow them to see their need and Your love and Your redemption, Your grace and Your mercy and Your forgiveness. Father, it's almost too wonderful for us to talk about at times. Everything I say about it falls short of what it really means that a soul would be saved today from eternity in hell and punishment for sins. And so we will just thank You for working, moving in our hearts, and even if today You might bring one to Yourself. We thank You in Thy Son's name we pray. Amen. It's kind of interesting. I have a lot of conversations with you and your families. And recently I've been talking with many of you about the difficulties of being a Christian in an environment that is not very Christian. Many of you have family members who are unsaved, that don't know Christ as their Lord and Savior. Many of you, probably most of you, work in a non-Christian and some an anti-Christian environment. You come to know Christ, and you're excited about that, your faith, and you want to be faithful to Him, but your friends and often your family members, they're not excited about it. And one of the things we talked about is why people don't get excited for us when Christ changes us. Lives get changed, sinful habits, begin to be dealt with. A person suddenly has joy and peace. Why is that so offensive to people today? So it's interesting, in Mark chapter 6, I know you're familiar with this, Christ goes back to his hometown of Nazareth. He's preaching and doing miracles. And we'll look at these verses a little later, but it's interesting what it says there about the people that he grew up with. He says, those people took offense at him. They weren't offended about what he was doing. They weren't even offended about what he was saying. But literally, they took offense at the person of Jesus Christ. Why? You know, why not say, hey, I may not believe, but, you know, you're doing good. You know, the miracles are great. Teaching's great. You know, why is it when a believer's life is changed, when your life is changed for the Lord Jesus Christ, why isn't the reaction, hey, that's great for you. I'm glad you're happy. You know, I may not be there yet, but I'm happy for you. Well, today as we go to 1 Peter chapter 4, God is going to speak to this issue. And how, as we believers in Jesus Christ, how can we keep that before us, that hope, that purpose, and in a society that is constantly assailing us and our beliefs, our morals, and the truth of God's Word. So if you're not there yet, I ask you to turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. Let me read the first 6 verses for us. It says, therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose, because he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. For the time already past is sufficient for you to have carried out the desires of the Gentiles, having pursued a course of sensuality, lust and drunkenness, carousing, drinking, parties, and abominable idolatry. In all this, they are surprised that you do not run with them into the same excesses of dissipation. And they malign you, but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For the gospel has for this purpose been preached even to those who are dead, that though they are judged in the flesh as men, they may live in the spirit according to the will of God. I want to start with verse 6 and kind of work back just a little bit here. Understanding verse 6 is going to help us get a handle on this and understand the rest of what God is saying to us. It's kind of difficult what he's saying here to understand. Verse 6 says, for the gospel has for this purpose been preached even to those who are dead, that though they are judged in the flesh as men, they may live in the spirit according to the will of God. I have to admit to you, I really struggled with what this meant. It's talking about preaching to dead people, you know, it's talking about dead people getting converted. I mean, there's no hardly any other place in Scripture that uses this kind of language. What exactly is it talking about here? Well, dead, we know, is often used as a reference in Scripture to the position of an unsaved person. They are dead in their trespasses and sin, someone outside of Christ. But that doesn't seem to fit here, that it's talking about necessarily an unsaved person. Actually, what this is talking about, this dead is different. It's a reference to people, to Christians, who will respond to the gospel. They are unsaved, they become Christians, but they will undergo great persecution. Many of them even will be martyred. They will lose their lives. They will be dead because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The context here is speaking about doing the will of God and suffering abuse for doing the will of God. Suffering abuse for walking against the current of society and the world attacking our faith. Literally it's saying, since for the gospel has for this purpose been preached even to those who are dead. For what purpose? For what reason has it been preached even to those who are going to die for their faith? For this purpose that it has been preached, that though they are judged in the flesh as men, in other words, men carry out a judgment against believers, men will take their lives, it says, that they may live in the Spirit according to the will of God. We preach the gospel because even though some will be martyred, some will be judged by men on this earth and be killed, God will make them alive in the Spirit. And really that kind of fits with the whole book, what it's talking about. If you remember, this book is written to believers when persecution struck in Jerusalem. They were spread out all amongst Asia, and the book of 1 Peter is written to these believers who have lost, some of them have lost everything physical in this life. And God is trying to encourage us as believers. What do you do as a Christian when this life, as it should for a Christian, is anti-God, is anti-Christ? Well, let's step back and grasp what God is saying here. How does this apply to me? One of the things we need to take away from here is that if you don't have a strong belief, if you don't have a strong faith in the afterlife of a Christian, if you don't understand that because you have asked Christ to forgive your sins, that one day, you're going to stand in eternity before God. And heaven is going to be opened up before you. And everything of this life is going to pass away. Everything that this life threw at you, all the injustices that have come our way, that's all going to be passed. For a believer, we're living for a life to come. And if you don't have a strong understanding in that, you don't understand that is what a Christian life is all about, then we're going to struggle in this world. You see, an unbeliever's life, rightfully so, take this, an unbeliever's life is summed up in eat, drink, be merry, for tomorrow we die. If an unbeliever has nothing to live for, no afterlife, then this is all we have, and this is all we can grasp onto. But for a believer, everything here, this, you know, our cars, our homes, our community, our vacations, you know, all the things that, you know, bring us happiness, all of those things are just waxing in comparison as to what is ahead in the life to come. It's kind of neat what it said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We'll put some of these verses up for you. It's speaking about love there. And it's speaking, you know, and somewhat about, you know, we use these verses for marriages about the love that a husband and wife are to share with each other. It says that love is patient. Love is kind and it's not jealous. Love does not brag. It's not arrogant. Love does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own. It's not provoked. It doesn't take into account a wrong suffered. It does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but it rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. Love endures all things. Now, isn't that great? We crave this sort of love. This is our goal, that we want to have that experience of love. And, you know, when a marriage starts and the love and the unity that we want to share between a man and a wife. But guess what? It says there in verse 12 at the end of this chapter, kind of summarizing this, says, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we'll see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I have been fully known." Now let me ask you, do you believe that? Do you believe that one day, the best that I can know of love on this side of eternity is like nothing but a shadow of something that is great that is going to be brought into my life? Is your life aligned with that truth, that no matter what this life can offer? I mean, think of the most loving time that you've had in your life, the most accepted and received and joy-filled that you've ever had. And that's all going to wax like a shadow compared to what we're going to feel like when we get in eternity. See, if you can't get your arms around that, you can't understand that as a Christian, it's going to be hard to stay in this world. It's going to be hard not to compromise. It's going to be hard to go to school and have your friends wanting to do certain things and responding to all the ads on the TV and what joy and all. It's going to be hard to stand with that if we don't understand that one day something greater is coming for all believers in Christ. It says in Revelation chapter 7, it says, "For this reason they are before the throne." He's talking about those who have suffered for Christ. It says, "For this reason they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne, who spread his tabernacle over them, They will hunger no longer, nor thirst anymore, nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb is the center of the throne. He will be their shepherd and will guide them to the springs of water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Now, do you believe that? Do you believe that that is what eternity is? Do you believe, do you understand that that is what is ahead of for you, for me, if you're a Christian? That God the great justice, is going to make everything right when we get to heaven. Every tear is going to be wiped away. Do you believe that if an unsaved world would attack us and try to destroy us, an unsaved world that is killing Christians, that one day, even though that is happening on this side of eternity, one day God will make them alive in the Spirit. And we're heavily involved with the gospel from Asia and going into to countries in that 1040 window that are very hostile to Christianity. And I was always struck when Gwen Cross was talking about the graduation ceremonies for the national pastors over there. And, you know, there'd be 100 pastors sitting there, and in the graduating ceremony, you know, the speaker would say, I want you to look around, you know, at everybody in this room. Within a couple years, you know, half of them are going to be gone. They're going to be martyred for their faith. Do you believe that even though this world deems Christians to be a problem, that your faith to be a threat, you to be a threat, and no matter what the world will do as a result of that, that one day, no matter what you lost on this side of eternity, that one day, God will make you alive in the Spirit. Do you believe in, and we could, you know, we might look at it, we might say, well, you know, we don't really face that kind of persecution in the United States, but you can argue from the greater to the lesser. You know, if we believe God is going to do that for somebody who stands up and dies for the name of Christ, well, today, you know, do you believe that God will resurrect and give glory and new life, you know, to those who take a stand in the marketplace for Him? Do you believe that God will also reward and make right anything that you would suffer for stepping out and living for Him, any loss that might come on this side of eternity? He said in verse 2 of 1 Peter 4, He says, so as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for the lusts of men, but we're to be living for the will of God. For the time already past is sufficient for you to have carried out the desires of the Gentiles. You already knew that kind of life. You know, having pursued, of course, of sensuality and lust and drunkenness and carousing, drinking, parties, and abominable idolatries. In all this, they are surprised that you do not run with them into the same excess of dissipation. And they malign you. You see, Jesus Christ changes our lives. Jesus Christ gives us new priorities, gives us new habits. But not because of it. Things aren't the same with some of your families, with some of the friends that you've had in the past. It's not the same at work. And quite honestly, it shouldn't be the same. Those relationships should all be different. You know, in verse 3, it talks about the time already past, you know, when we carried out the desires. You know, when we were part of pursuing sensuality and lust and drunkenness and all sorts of sinfulness. But now your relationship, it's all changed. It's different. And verse 4 says, in all this, they are surprised that you do not run with them. You've stopped doing those things. You know, and you don't run into the same excess of dissipation. And they say they malign you for it. That dissipation means riotness or literally an unsavedness. That's a trait of a person who doesn't have a relationship with God. And it's tough to stand. It's tough not to compromise under the pressure of the world. And humanly speaking, you cannot stand. Slowly your resolve will be chipped away. it will be worn down. You know, there's not a small current against God and against Christianity. It's a tsunami. And we can stand and we can stand and we can stand. But time will pass. And if it's in our own strength, habits are going to return. So what do? How can you stand? Well, verse 1 says, therefore, let's look at the example of Christ. Therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose. Because he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. How do we not follow our old sinful ways? How do we not fall back into those same patterns? It refers to the suffering of Christ, standing, have that same purpose, that same resolve. You know, what does it mean that Christ suffered in the body? Well, it's a reference to what he did when he was on this side of eternity, when he was life on this earth. You know, how he suffered. And we remembered how he suffered. You know, just summarizing it. You know, his own family tried to discourage him. The town he grew up in, it says in Mark chapter 6, it says, you know, they saw him and said, where did this man get these things? And what is this wisdom given to him? And such miracles as these performed by his hands. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joses and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Religious leaders misrepresented his claims. False witnesses lied about what he said and what he did. Soldiers mocked him. And eventually the world took their Savior and they beat him and they crucified him, hung him upon the cross. And Christ has gone through what a Christian living a Christian life. He experienced it all. All the mediums of what can happen to us as you're living your faith for Christ. And he suffered in the body. And says, therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with this purpose. Have the same purpose. To do the will of God. No matter what happened to Christ, no matter how he was reacted to, Christ was here to carry out the will of God. Now, do you see your life like that today? If you're a Christian, do you see your life as I am here, you know, that God has a will for me? Sometimes it's a mind-blowing thing, isn't it? That God has a purpose for me, for Larry Marvel. That he even knows I exist. He even knows that I'm here on this planet. I mean, some 6 billion people. But think about it. God has saved you for a reason. God has saved you for a purpose. And only in striving to be what God has saved you, the reason God has saved you, that purpose that he has called you to, that is the only way that you are going to stand against the tidal wave of oppression that you're going to find in the world. I mean, consider these scenarios. You go to work. And, you know, the other guys at work, they're always chumming up together, telling their little jokes. And, you know, every once in a while they go out to work afterwards. Hey, you know, we're going to go get a drink. And, you know, they can stop by and get a drink and hang out. But you don't know. But you do feel left out. You know, all day at work, they're all chummy in, and you're over there standing on the fringe. Never seem to be fully accepted. But today, they ask you to come out with them. Hey, want to come out and have a few beers with us, you know, after work? And who knows what's been going on? I imagine Satan's been working in your life, and you're particularly low and vulnerable at this moment. If you have not armed yourself with the attitude of Christ, that I would rather suffer in this body right now, I would rather suffer here, than compromise God's will for my life. If you're not armed with that attitude, the world is going to break you down, and your life is going to be a life of compromise. Or you become a Christian, but your spouse isn't saved. Or your immediate family, you know, they're unsaved. You want to walk in the will of God, but these relationships, you know, strain the areas that you know are wrong. I have that. Many of you know the vast majority of my family isn't saved. And every single gathering is around alcohol and coarseness and crudeness. It's difficult. It's difficult to love your family and to love them, to be part of their lives. When you know being part of their lives, you're going to come into contact with certain things. And you're going to make a stand. And then there's going to be conflict. And they're going to judge you. And they're going to think that you're criticizing them. And you think that you're better than them. All of these things come. What do? You love these people very much. But it seems your faith is putting up a wall between you and them. The price seems high to follow Jesus Christ. If the price seems high to follow Jesus Christ, it's because it is. And we have forgotten that there's a price to pay because of our faith. To be a testimony. To be that light in the midst of darkness. You know, the disciples were struggling with this. It says in Mark chapter 10, verse 28, it says, Peter, he's coming to Jesus, and he begins to say to him, "Behold, we have left everything and followed you." I mean, they were an example of total commitment, totally being sold out for Christ. And here's what Jesus reminds them. You know, they've given up a lot. The disciples went through a lot, and they're going to go through it. Many of them are going to lose their life. The vast majority of them will be martyred for their faith. Here's what Jesus says. Jesus said, "Truly I say to you," verses 29 and 30, "there is no one who has left his house or brothers or sisters or mothers or fathers or children or farms for my sake and for the gospel's sake, but that he will receive 100 times as much now in this present age, houses and brothers and sisters, mothers and children's farms, along with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life." We may suffer loss, physical loss. I might literally lose my home. I might literally lose my family. But I've gained family. I've gained brothers and sisters in Christ. We are part of a community, a body of believers. And Jesus reminds people, says, yes, so we have this on this side of eternity. But he says, I want to remind you on the other side of eternity. Along with all of these things, it's going to come eternal life. That's what's waiting for us. In Luke chapter 9, verse 23, it says this, "And he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world, but he forfeits himself?" In the end, what will it matter if my physical family, my workplace, my neighborhood, in getting their acceptance, I have to compromise my faith? What is it in this world that Satan is offering you that is worth eternal life, that is worth the joy that the Lord Jesus Christ is offering us? It's having the same mind and attitude of Christ, that I would rather lose a friend or family member than lose God's will in my life. It's a trust that God will one day make all things right. Verse 5, it says, "But they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead," and trusting that one day God balances the scales. It's the lordship of Christ that you accepted, I accepted, and that I make a great claim of, that's based on the blood of Jesus Christ, that he is not only my Savior, but he is the Lord of my life. And that I am crucified with Christ. "Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And this life that I now live, I live in the power of God." That is the Christian life. So let me ask you as we close here. Are you paying any price for your faith? Does your faith cost you anything? Jesus said it would. to live in this world, you will suffer persecution. Matter of fact, he said, be careful. He says, beware when all men speak well of you. Because if the world doesn't have a problem with your life, if the world's accepting you, you're probably compromising just to be accepted. So, Father, I'm going to ask you to move in our hearts, to move in my life, Lord. Father, help me to weed out those areas that I am not taking a stand for you. Father, I pray that you will bring conviction in my life. I thank you that you love me too much to allow me to be tossed to and fro by the world. Father, I pray that you will help me to plant my feet firmly on the solid rock, on your word. And Lord, I pray that you will help me to realize the reality of my eternity to come. With joy, Lord, I embrace loss for the sake of the gospel. Lord, I pray that you will use this, our testimonies, our lives, to just be a witness to those around us. Yes, the world will laugh, they'll scorn, but Father, they watch, and they are searching. They're holding on to things that are shifting sand. And Father, one day, they need to know where the anchor is. They need to know where the solid rock is. So, Father, I want to be there to point them. I want to be there to have been an example of where they can come to find forgiveness and hope and joy. It's a daunting task, Father, to be used to be a vessel of yours. I thank you that we do not do this in our own power and strength. Thank you for the Bible. We have so freely the ability to read. Thank you for the ability that we have to humble ourselves before you and pray at any moment to come before you. I thank you for your Holy Spirit that you give each true believer that is working within us, convicting us, challenging us, conferring with you that we might do the will of God. We love you, Lord. Just bring eternity in full focus into our lives as we live on the side of eternity. We pray these things in thy Son's precious name. Amen. Hymn number 506, if you would turn there and stand, you can get it. Number 506. Proclamation we're making to God, I'd rather have Jesus. Let's sing that first verse.